Chapter 4. Ellera tied the final string and tightened it carefully. There was a thrum, almost but not quite tangible, that pulsed from the harp. Ellera grinned and strummed gently. The sound wasn't like anything she'd expected, certainly not from a harp. It was like the thrum, this time audible, and vibrating through the harp, and yet not sounding at all musical. She looked around to see if there was any effect on anything in her room. It didn't seem that there was, unless the effect was very slight. She flapped her wings and tested moving around, determining that there was no effect to herself either. She strummed again at the harp, and it seemed that the strings were stronger this time, the sound a bit louder, more resonant. Still not quite musical, though. More like a monotone hum than anything else she could name. She strummed a third time, but it seemed that whatever change had happened was done. It didn't feel any different this time. She jumped as her door opened without even a knock, but no one was there. There was a small mew that drew her gaze down to see a cat, rubbing against the doorframe. "You scared me," Ellera scolded lightly, frowning at the cat. It tipped its head to the side, blinking slowly at her, and Ellera recognized it then as Azar's familiar. "Oh, did you hear the harp?" He certainly was a smart cat, and with his connection to Azar, might well be able to sense magic, too. The cat meowed again, staring at her far more intently than a normal animal would have. Ellera strummed the harp again, but the cat just blinked at her and then turned around and left. She sighed, disappointed. Perhaps it had been more of a coincidence than she'd thought. Unless... "Wait, don't tell Azar," she whispered loudly, running to the door. The cat flicked his tail at her, looking back blandly. "Please?" She tried looking at him pleadingly. The cat just turned and trotted away again. She tried not to worry. It was only a cat, and probably couldn't really speak. But she'd be in a lot of trouble if anyone found out she was making the harp. Had already made it. She decided quickly, hiding the harp under her pillow and running in the same direction the cat had gone, hoping to catch him before he reached Azar. To her surprise, the moment she turned the corner, the cat was sitting there waiting. As soon as she caught up, though, he ran ahead again. She chased the cat along the hallways, not quite fast enough to catch or corner him. "Oh, come on, please stop," she pleaded, tired of running and hoping that the cat really did understand speech. The cat did stop, meowing loudly and sitting in front of the door. Ellera panted, leaning against the wall. "What, were you leading me here?" "It wasn't anywhere special. The students' bedrooms were up ahead, but there wasn't anything here. The door was probably just a closet." The cat meowed again, pawing at the door. Ellera wondered if it really was something or just a mouse, until she heard a small, "Shh." There was someone in there. Someone who knew the cat and didn't want him to be meowing and pawing at the door. Ellera knocked gently at the door, but there was no response other than a quiet rustle. She narrowed her eyes, staring down the door and trying to figure out if it was worth it to open it. "Hello?" she said first, pitching her voice to be light, friendly, and a little curious. Ellera decided, on receiving no answer, to open the door. It really was a closet, full of linens, but the bottom few shelves had been removed, and the linens that had been on them were arranged into a nest, inside of which was sitting a boy, staring up at her in alarm and worry. He was the same one she'd been seeing recently, apparently not only studying here sneakily, but also staying here without the knowledge of the teachers. Ellera sighed. What was she supposed to do about this now? She knew too much to keep letting it go. "Please don't tell anyone," he whispered hoarsely. He was biting down hard on his lip, and his chin trembled slightly. Ellera sat down on the ground, not surprised to see the cat go right to the boy and curl up in his lap. "I won't," she said, sighing again. "But I'd like to know what exactly is going on." He looked down at the cat, petting him slowly and chewing on his lower lip. He was getting ready to lie, that was plain. But he was young, probably close to 13. She didn't blame him for unsubtle tactics, though she was going to try and get the truth from him. "Why don't we start with your name? I think you've heard mine is Ellera." His forehead creased, and he shook his head, eyes still fixed down into his lap. Ellera frowned in confusion. "You won't tell me your name?" He shifted awkwardly, looking almost shy, before mumbling, "You can call me Keon." The phrasing, though mumbled, with a word or two dropped out, hit her as familiar and took only a few more seconds to click. She huffed and crossed her arms. "Just because I look strange doesn't mean I'm a fairy. They wouldn't let any fairies in here anyway. No one's taking your name. He just shrugged slightly, curling in on himself. Ellora held out a hand. How about you come with me and we'll get some breakfast and you can tell me why you're here, okay? He looked up suspiciously. You won't tell anyone? No, Ellora said firmly. I'll see what I can do to help you. Hiding in a closet won't last forever. He frowned stubbornly, but finally stood, ignoring her offered hand. The cat meowed at them, curling up in the linens, apparently to go to sleep. So, are you here just for the classes or to learn something specific? Ellora asked, trying to infuse a bit of a lighter tone into the conversation. Keon didn't seem to think it lightened anything, hunching his shoulders. I'm looking for a way to find someone. Ellora nodded slowly. Oh, so that's why you were looking into Ifior. Ifior was known, among other things, for having lost or misplaced many of his creations. It was speculated that, had he been able to make the tracking spell earlier in his life, the abilities of magic users would have advanced 10 or 20 years from his discoveries alone. Ellora had often wished she could have met him. Keon nodded. But I don't have what I'd need to use his search spell. Ellora considered it for a few moments. Perhaps there's a less powerful spell you could learn more easily? He shook his head. He's been missing for years. A small spell wouldn't work. He? Who are you looking for? Keon narrowed his eyes suspiciously at her. I'm not saying. Ellora felt a prickle of annoyance. Keon, you're a kid. Looking for someone who went missing years ago when you were an even smaller kid. You don't have an adult with you and are hiding in a school full of magic, and I'm sure they won't be happy to find out about that. You need help. And I really can't do much if you don't tell me anything. Keon bristled. I was doing perfectly fine by myself. I don't need you. Stubborn. Ellora decided to try another way. I don't think Azar's familiar would have led me to you if you didn't really need any help. Keon frowned intensely, glowering down at the floor. I can't tell you who he is without telling the whole thing, and I don't trust you enough to tell you everything. Ellora reluctantly nodded. It was at least more understandable. Well, then at least, so I can help you find a spell, is he a friend? Family? If it's your dad, that would narrow down things quite a bit. There's a lot of spells for finding missing fathers. Keon shook his head. My brother, kind of. I think the magic would acknowledge him as my brother. Half-brother? Ellora guessed. Keon shook his head, but didn't elaborate. They'd nearly reached the kitchen, so Ellora didn't press the question. Instead, she tried to think of what kinds of searching spells she already knew of. Perhaps they could help her, too, figuring out what the harp wanted. There was one or two that came to mind, but those were more of the lost socks or needing directions type, and unlikely to work for something like a brother missing for several years, or a harp that just felt like it needed something. Keon sat across the table from her in the dining hall, mostly ignoring her as he wolfed down several bowls of oatmeal with far too much honey. Ellora ate much more slowly, trying to remember the names of books where she'd seen search spells written about. She thought of 4, and a 5th was hovering on the edges of her mind, a book about getting favors from fairies, though she couldn't seem to recall the exact name. She was fairly certain she knew which shelf to look on, though. Then she abruptly remembered that the students were taking her job in the library for a few days. And while she might have the time to search for books, she very much did not want to run into them this soon, when they'd still be smarting from the assigned punishment. This certainly held up her plans of helping Keon. Perhaps she could just send him off with the titles for the books she knew, and hope it took him a few days to figure out whether he would get anything helpful from them? Even one more day, and it would likely be safer for her to go back into the library. And he didn't seem to need her company as much as her knowledge. But even still, now she knew he didn't even have a room, she was loath to leave him by himself for fear something would happen. There was the sound of a bell, and Keon stood up quickly. I have to get to class, he said, leaving his dishes and waving slightly as he caught up with the departing first years. Ellora hadn't expected him to still go to classes, and was caught off guard, just managing a wave back as the crowd of young teens left the room. And that left her with nothing to do. No plans, at least. She could go back and see if there were any more changes or clues with the harp, or perhaps she could go and find Asha. Or, which seemed to her the best idea yet, she could get the harp and bring it with her to find Asha, and then show her once she was done with her work for the day. Fully decided, she carried hers and Keon's dishes back to the kitchen. Ellora, the cook greeted, surprising her with an almost sly smile. I heard you had a good evening last night. Ellora almost winced. She'd hoped Millie would wait at least a little without telling the entire staff her assumptions, but instead she smiled. Yes, I had a nice evening. Thank you so much for the picnic basket. The cook beamed. Maybe bring her inside for dinner sometime. If it's not too often, I can give you a little help from my end of things. She winked knowingly. Ellora kept smiling, unsure how exactly to broach the I'm not dating Asha topic when the cook hadn't actually outright said that she was. She decided to glance off the topic in a similar way to the cook. I'll try to bring her. Perhaps she'll become friends with you all as well. The cook's face held a distinct note of confusion, but Ellora turned and left, feeling very awkward and like she'd said entirely the wrong thing. Friends. Somehow, it didn't feel right. It did, but it also didn't. She knew enough to rule out dating as the term she was searching for, but friends also felt wrong, and she wasn't sure exactly why. Ellora shook away the troublesome thoughts. She was going to show Asha her harp and enjoy spending time with her. That was enough for now. No need to get worked up over what that might be called. She went upstairs and put her apron on to hold the harp in. It should be safe there. Though, just to be safe, she wrapped it in a spare shirt first, so no one would be able to see what it was if they could see into the pocket. Now she just had to find Asha. She was probably somewhere on the grounds, and probably still at work or learning, but it should be okay for Ellora to come watch, as long as she didn't distract Asha too much. The school grounds were pretty large, though, and Ellora wasn't sure where to start looking. Well, a walk would be nice anyway. She left through a side door and decided that she'd go to the greenhouses first. But Asha wasn't in either of them. She checked the food garden, close to the school buildings and growing a variety of herbs and vegetables, but Asha wasn't there either. She went to the forest, or rather, the tiny corner of it on school grounds, where the underbrush of plants with magical properties was encouraged to grow. The groundskeeper was there, but without Asha. Thankfully, he was able to point her in the right direction. I sent her to the school nurses so she could bring some supplies to them and see what they're working with. He smiled kindly at Ellora, and thankfully without that knowing smirk that most other people gave her when she had asked if they'd seen Asha. The rumor mill was relentless. It had been just as bad when two of the professors had been seen hugging. To be fair, they were now in a relationship, so it had been correct in their case, but still. Was it not interesting enough around the school? Why did so many people feel the need to talk about potential relationships? Ellora finally reached the nurse's office and knocked at the door. "Oh, hello," one of them greeted as he opened the door. "Wow, I guess you're coming in for that black eye, huh?" Ellora had nearly forgotten about that with everything else. "Not really. I actually came to see Asha. I was told she was here." He raised an eyebrow, but then shrugged. "Sure, she's over there. She's a bit busy, though. You may need to wait a while." Ellora nodded with a small smile and then went over to where he'd pointed. Asha glanced up, smiled, and then went back to writing in a notebook. She was standing in front of a wall of drawers and cabinets, one of which was open in front of her. Ellora could see a yellowish-brown powder inside the tiny drawer. There were labels on all of them, scrawled in handwriting she couldn't decipher. Ellora sat down in a chair nearby, more than content to watch Asha work. Until the thought hit her that it might be creepy to do that. She ought not to stare. But she enjoyed watching Asha, looking all confident and serious, though she didn't understand why. She'd only met Asha a few days ago, and now here she was spilling all her secrets last night and then now sitting and staring at her. Why did she like her so much and so fast? Was it just that Asha seemed genuinely kind and interested in her? If that was all it took, Ellora shivered at the thought of someone using that to take advantage of her. Asha wouldn't do that, though, she was almost sure. Then again, she'd only known her a few days. She didn't know enough to be very sure. There were only assumptions and instincts and emotions. But they all pointed towards Asha being absolutely amazing. Ellora glanced up from her lap, where she'd been staring at her hands while she mused, and caught a small grin from Asha. She grinned back, a warm rightness chasing away all her worries. Asha closed the drawer and opened the one next to it. "I'll be a bit. Do you want something to do?" Ellora perked up. "Oh, is there a way I can help?" Asha nodded, her gaze fixed on what she was writing in her book. "I've been focused on noting the properties of these medicines, and I put off the organizing I was meant to do until the end. But if you want, I'm sure they wouldn't mind if you helped. If you look in some of these on that end, there's individual packets, and they need to be organized by date, with the oldest ones forward to be used first. Unless you come across any more than a year old, some of those need to go. You can show me, and I'll tell you whether they stay or not." Ellera nodded intently. She could definitely do some organizing, especially if it helped Asha. "And if it's not in packets, just leave it for now, and hopefully I'll be done before then and I can take over again. Sound good?" Asha looked up from her book to see Ellera's response. Ellera nodded quickly. "Yeah, I can do that." Asha smiled in thanks, her round cheeks pushing her eyes half-closed, all crinkly at the corners. She was so cute, and having it all directed at Ellera made her feel warm and happy. She went right to work. It was interesting to see which of the medicines were magical. Not that they said so, but even with the paper of the packet between her and the powder, some of them made her fingers tingle. Most of them felt nice, but with some the zing was almost painful. They must be very powerful. Ellera wondered what they were used for. And then she realized she could just ask. She held one up by the top of the packet where she wasn't holding any of the medicine, just paper. "What's this one for?" Asha turned her head towards Ellera, still looking at her book till she'd finished writing the sentence. Oh, that's actually one of the ones they used to help that student the other day. It's supposed to stop the effects of most ingested magic. It activates once it's been swallowed." "Seems pretty active already," Ellera said, frowning at the packet. Asha looked confused. "What do you mean?" "Well, it stings, even through the packet."
"Sting? Wait, you can feel the magic!" Ellera said, far too loudly for a room with nurses nearby that could overhear.
Ellera covered Asha's mouth abruptly, trying to frown in a way that showed alarm and not anger.
"Yes, but shh."
Asha's eyes widened in understanding.
"Sorry, I forgot,"
she mumbled past Ellera's hand. Ellera took her hand away slowly, trying to see if the nurses had heard.
"Can you feel the magic of all of them, so I can write it down?" Asha asked in an excited whisper.
"I can, but I can't tell you much about it other than how it feels."
Asha nodded eagerly. "That'll be plenty. I'd love to have another person like you here and compare the differences in how you both feel it. But I can write it down, and I'll be sure to take this book with me when I leave, and I'll ask others who can feel magic so I can hear how it feels for them and compare them."
The thought of Asha leaving stabbed into Ellera's chest. "There's other people who can do it at the school," she offered, a bit weakly, and hoped it was disguised enough as just trying to be quiet. "Some of the older professors, and I'm sure there's a student or two that has inherent magic and could feel them." Asha was nodding excitedly, flipping to a different part of the book to write more.
"Do you have any names you can give me? Or wait, first I want to know how you feel the magic, then names after. I'm so curious, what does that one feel like?"
Ellera considered, shaking off unpleasant thoughts of the future and focusing on happy, excited Asha now. "It stings, like, not quite as strong as a nettle, but it's continuous."
"Okay, and which ones sting? I want to see if they're some of the ones I already grouped together."
Asha's eyes were bright as she opened a drawer.
"How about this one?"
Ellera picked up the packet.
"Yes, this one does too. Not as strong, though."
Asha started writing again very quickly.
"That's interesting. I'd have thought it would be stronger. What about that one?"
Ellera picked it up and heard the door open.
"It does a little, but it's also kind of warm."
Asha nodded, serious and excited at once, flipping several pages before writing more. Ellera heard a familiar voice grumbling as if he'd come through the door while talking.
"Fine, but they said I had to come get checked out. I don't need anything."
Ellera peeked around the side of the storage wall, surprised to see Keon holding his stomach. He looked more than a little pale. He'd been fine just a bit ago. What had happened?
"Who is it?" Asha asked, also peeking out after she'd noticed Ellera's attention was elsewhere.
"His name is Keon. I kind of know him," Ellera said. "I hope he's okay."
"Well, I'm here to help," Asha said, walking out and over. "Hey there, what's the matter with your stomach?"
Keon shrugged. "Just hurts some. I probably ate too much or something."
"Why did they send you here?" Ellera asked, despite it not being her place.
Keon startled when he noticed her.
"Why are you here?"
"I came to find Asha. What happened?"
He shrugged again, looking away sourly.
"I threw up."
"Are you okay?"
Ellera asked, concerned, and held out a hand to his forehead. There was a zing of something that ran through her, and that not quite audible thrum came from the harp in her apron. She jerked back, alarmed, but Keon looked almost more alarmed than she was. His mouth opened partly, but instead of speaking, he turned and ran.